irrelevant when it comes to the agenda in general conferences like this, usually is where you need to speak to. So thanks for sticking around. One of the interesting things about John Bobby, for me, is that as a young man, he was greatly influenced by two intellectual developments at one time. On the one hand, we had within psychoanalysis these big split away movements of the object relations theorists, particularly people like Melanie Klein, who, as you know, was obsessed with the mother child relationship and studied that very intimately, and the developing representations of children were gathering as they were growing about mothers and objects around them. And you had Ronald Fairbairn as well, who very clearly made this split with some traditional psychoanalytic doctrine, saying that actually the core of our psyche is really not this need to gratify the desire to release emotion and to express our emotions in that way, but rather to seek objects in our environment, to seek relationships with other people. So that was one intellectual learning. Of course, following that, psychoanalysis paid much greater attention to the parent relationship. Analyst and the patient, and what was going on between them. At the same time, we had the emergent field of pathology, the study of animal behavior, and particularly people like Rob Klein, who probably worked in Britain. And Rob Klein is 89 this year, I'm sure we wish him well. One of the things, of course, that ethology taught him is that there were very, very strong similarities and parallels between human and behavior, and we know about some of those. And so, very much, Bobby saw this as a right time for the unification, drawing these two themes within analytic and pathology into what he later, of course, called attachment theory. So, the central to his beliefs really was that in our biological nature, we have this instinctive need attachment. And the fear of separation, loss, damage, and abandonment are the core of our internal working models of the relational world as well. And here, of course, he's invoking this idea of an internal working model, this idea of the mental model of the world, and of course, that notion of how we represent the world cognitively has been used in many different branches of psychology for decades. And his particular focus, of course, was on relational world, whereas others have looked at it more conceptually and how we represent the world in other areas as well. And finally, he was arguing that our relational experiences lead us to make assumptions about future relationships. So far, so familiar, I'm sure, to everyone here. So what happens to attachments in the context of cancer? Well, as you can see, I think it's a rather gothic typeface for cancer. And that's because more than any other disease that affects humans, cancer carries with it enormous cultural baggage and historical meaning. It's a disease that's still feared greatly today. When I started in the field 20 years ago, people were unable to utter the word cancer with within consulting. But things have come a long way, certainly in the medical area. This engraving, you know, was made in 1700 as a testimonial from the Vice Chancellor of this university, Oxford University, to Sir William Reed, a surgeon who had, as it says in this engraving, cut off a very large cancerated breast from the body. This was Hopkins of Oxford in this town, in 1689. Now, she must have survived if the engraving was made 11 years after the surgery was performed. But it makes you realize how rare an event this must have been for a woman to survive breast cancer in around 1700. These days, over 86% of women with breast cancer will survive 5 years or more. So there have been this extraordinary advances in cancer treatment medically. On the other hand, it's still a very tough disease to cure. So the current statistics are that a third of people in this room will get cancer at some point in their life, and a quarter of people in this room will probably die from cancer. Happily, it correlates with age, so the older you are, unfortunately, the more likely you are to get it. And even to this day, treatments in cancer are extremely tough. So surgery, radiotherapy, and chemotherapy, and characters, cutting burning, poisoning, and unfortunately, it's uncomfortably close to the truth. There's still very tough treatments and take a big chunk out of your life. Treatments like those of leukemia can take up to 2 years of your life. And during that time, of course, you're facing enormous problems of uncertainty. Because nobody's ever going to tell you you're cured, they're going to tell you the treatment went well or did not go well. So you'll never know until you find yourself surviving some years later. And during that time, of course, people are confronting their mortality, confronting the possibility, the real possibility that they may die from this disease. So, if one was to be a bit curious about this, I guess one could describe this as a strange situation in the way that things were described for children, albeit this is for adults, so I'm taking liberties with that term, of course. But I think there are some interesting parallels with strange situations for children as well. One of the things about strange situations, as we know, is that they invoke a very strong need for protection. As we heard from that written earlier, and something you probably all know. And by way of demonstrating this, I'm going to draw a few quotes from people's personal diaries during the course of their cancer and treatment. Now, these were not written for me or for any other researcher. They were kept for the person concerned and sometimes for their families, and only later they shared it with us. I said, ask my colleague, Claire Lloyd, who is a cancer researcher, and I put out all of these diaries. It felt like a bad dream. One minute life was chugging along, the next, well, someone switched the wheels. Somewhere in some parallel universe, life was continuing to chug along. Here in this one, where I was unconsciously stuck after some truly looking last moment, mammograms, ultrasound, poor biopsies, sitting in a square of glass, weeping, apologizing, or on my shoulder and soft head. The world was suddenly upside down, guilty. I and my body had let us down, feeling the kids. I realize it's a very poignant quote to absorb this emotionally quite taxing for us all. I want to point out another list of a couple of features of that is a powerful quote. You'll notice that this woman was not simply thinking about her own survival at the moment, she was also thinking about him and the kids. And you'll notice also that she's talking about the parallel universe that unfolds. So the beginning is part of a massive change in her life. Massive change in her life trajectory, if you will. And there's a quite traumatic quality to that, I think you'd agree. And that's something we see throughout. So I'm going to just show you four examples of how I think attachment theory has a part to play in helping us understand what's going on in cancer as we see it. One thing, oncologists and surgeons use quite different outcome measures to those of psychologists. We have rather woolly and difficult ones to measure. Oncologists and surgeons have very high outcomes, what we live for, we die. And the characteristic way to measure success is 5-year survival, and I mentioned it earlier in blood breast cancer. So, for example, from 2005 to 2009, 9% of people in England with lung cancer survived 5 years or more. So, people with lung cancer. 9% of 5 years survival. That's a good health promotion message for any of you who still smoke. Now, survival in those terms is not perhaps what you and I might think of survival, but it's an interesting statistic because, in fact, our patients very often invest about 5 years quite strongly in a measure of their survival. So, what you should be able to aim for. Of course, survival curves don't really work like that. They are our core curves. And while the threat diminishes, it doesn't exactly go away. Nonetheless, it evokes in all of us an enormous need to care for our dependents. And that often precedes our need to care for ourselves. So as a parent, you would likely want to think about your own offspring for your own needs. And that's exactly what happens. And I recall, I just come to my head now, one of the patients referred to me. Very first patients referred to when I started the was referred with quite intrusive thoughts and images of her children standing by the gravestone at her funeral. And she was unable to get these thoughts out of her mind, intruding, and so on. This was not an unrealistic thought at all, her prognosis was poor, and it was very likely to happen. But these kind of concerns are very real and need to be considered and worked with intensively. But also to know that you and they will not be alone or abandoned in the future. And again, that's a very natural attachment theme. So critically, what is it that we can do to help support healthcare professionals to contain these patient fears and needs? In this regard, I'm lucky to work academically at least with the Department of Palliative Medicine. And palliative medicine is the one branch of medicine which never abandons, who never says we don't really care, you'll have to leave our services now or this time. Palliative medicine always has something to work towards and makes it very clear from the beginning that they will never abandon the patient, they will see them through to the end. My second example comes around the impact of the threat of cancer on relationships. Little shit. Here I was, totally bald, bar a bit of downy hair, still not having completed my course of chemo, and he's yelling verbally abusive. He hasn't said it, but I think he resented my freaky appearance. Maybe it frightens him, a visual reminder of my condition. Just perhaps he's jealous of the attention of sympathy that I'm being given. You can see there's a lot going on. And one of the reasons there's a lot going on is that it becomes very clear that it isn't simply the patient who's having to adjust their learning models in the relational world. Clearly, everybody connected to the patient is having to do so as well. So everyone's being threatened, everyone's having to adjust their relationship constellations. So relationship strain is extremely well indeed, so I do a lot of couples work. And very often, there appears to be, to my view, a reawakening of old attachment patterns and how care and trust are transacted within relationships, within families, and so on. I thought I'd just a very, very brief clinical example of a woman who was referred to me a few months ago, who was refusing to. She had a local recurrence of breast cancer, which required a little bit of surgery, followed by a short course of radiotherapy. Not a very difficult treatment by standards of cancer treatment. And one of them would have taken her just a couple, 2 or 3 weeks to complete. But she was refusing to have this treatment, even though it increased her chance of survival by about 30%, 35%, a chance that anyone else in the room would grab. I began to take the history, and what became very clear to me was that she'd had a whole lifelong history of being bullied by men, predominantly her father, her husband, and now her 18-year-old son. And during the course of coming to that realization, she began to realize that actually she experienced her oncologist and surgeon urging her to have this treatment, as a bullying her as well, bullying her to have treatment while she was saying to him, I think on this occasion, on that day, she'd take. As it was, after about 6 sessions of her working with these thoughts and making these realizations, she did choose to have the treatment. And there are 8 of them in the final. She said to me that one of the things that made the difference was the fact that I have not expressed an opinion on whether she should have her surgery and radiotherapy or not. In fact, what she did experience with me was some man who unusually didn't bully her to do anything. So I think that says something about the transplant's relationship as well. I want to just briefly mention young couples, because this is often a very poignant thing. When a couple has only recently formed, there are affectional bonds with one another, and that's quite fragile sometimes. So when cancer affects one or other, instead of turning to one another for that support, they return to the family origins. And that puts huge strains on that relationship. So I'm working through to understand some of the hurt and the cause. And finally, this example, allowing parents to be the people they happen to be is something that, as adults, who sometimes have to draw in the support of parents again, maybe after many years of being dependent on our parents, we can struggle to do that. We go back to the old attachment patterns where we resent that our parents perhaps are not perfect, that they're not as good down that we wish to do with the field. And so we struggle in that. And one of the struggles was, you know, as I say, adults, both of sometimes, and now their parents, to be the people they happen to be in what they're meeting with us, as fellow adults are probably doing their best. And again, that's one of the aspects of the world. If you're interested in some of these views across the lifespan, these parallel interesting paper parallels in many ways that we once printed earlier on. But it's an interesting review paper by Bernard Hume, who's a Belgian psychologist, who did this interesting review paper, which he was arguing that close attachments and in many ways in which this can be enacted, of course, in the mind as a whole. But the close attachments facilitate the cognitive adjustments to change and help people regulate their emotions throughout the lifespan. I do remember that paper in emotion review. And in response to that, really, that notion that we need invited support to process and make sense of experience, 15 years ago we started the Information Support Center, or the Ecology Center, which is staffed entirely by ex-service users and people affected by events along the way. And they provide support and advice and information to new diagnosis. And it sets up a very good sense, obviously a very important message for new patients, but can provide something like that to come by their support. Now I'll just mention another example, which is the symbolic role of doctors. Doctors actually hold within society a very interesting symbolic place as being, if you like, benign figures of authority, of wisdom, of reassurance when we get physically ill. And we grew up knowing about a doctor from a very young age. And I think when we are obviously threatened by illness, we seek the support of doctors and best attachment figures, if you like, objects of parental attachment, and we invest them with elaborate wishes as a result. And here's another quote which perhaps illustrates this. I suddenly feel that he's no longer the center of my universe as he's been for the last 3 months. Quite a big step in my rehabilitation. The center of my universe. He speaks softly and I'm afraid it's better. He looked straight into my eyes and there was a connection. I'm grateful for that, though I really wanted to stuff those words back into his mouth and say something different. After a pause, he sticks the mammogram x-ray up on the wall and the walls look like this. Now, there's been a great deal of investment in clinical micro skills training, communication skills training for doctors, but actually, I think there's something more important to get the patients are looking for. He looks straight into my eyes and there's a connection. That's what we're looking for. That's what people are looking for. I don't know how you teach that, but I think it's very powerful, and then people know it when they see it. Evolutionary psychologists, of course, have found it. Before my final slide, I'm just going to review, just to remind ourselves of what all we did tell us about what the therapeutic tasks are. To provide patients with a secure base from which to explore their concerns. To encourage the patient to consider the relationships they've had throughout their life. To enable patients to examine their relationship with the therapist, or as the transformative relationship, therapeutic relationship. To encourage patients to consider how their current expectations, perceptions, feelings, and emotions may be a product of events and situations encountered earlier in life. I think probably whatever school of therapy you particularly buy into, I think we probably all agree with that notion. And finally, to enable patients to see that the models that they talk about themselves and others may not be appropriately justified in their current circumstances. So to enable them to consider alternatives more in line with their aspirations and values. So I think, right, this is my final slide, I promise you. So the way I look at it is that if you're working with people with life-threatening illness of any sort, people are looking for a secure base. They're also looking for somebody who and that's another really possible term, the notion of a mother or a parent containing a vulnerable child who is very much in distress and angry, frustrated, or raging about the world. To hold on to that child until the screaming and the distress abates and we can begin to comfort the child. So a secure base from which the client can make sense of events, this unfolding trauma that they've been going through. And there are many ways, of course, in which people do that, through kindness, through writing, as we've seen in those diaries, through personal reflection, perhaps more on our own, and even through meditative practices such as prayer, and that's been shown in personal awareness and effective as well. But also a secure base from which to come and restore some narrative continuity in our lives, to recalibrate our mental models of the world, not simply about the relation of worlds, but many others, the course of their life, the direction of their life, perhaps their bodies, their sense of self, their spiritual beliefs. These are important. To now enable people to reclaim personal resources and qualities that have not been lost. Very often serious illness, because of the nature of our intensities, it strips people bare of their identity. People fail to recognize themselves in the person they were. And finally, to re-engage people with a changing world and to help them develop new meaningful goals for the future around the vulnerable shortages. Thank you very much for listening.